welcome. Nice to see you all. I'm Inge van de Ende. I'm a data scientist at Dexter Energy. We forecast renewable energy production. And today I'm going to talk about conformal prediction, and especially how you can apply it to calibrate probabilistic time series forecast. So in a talk earlier today, it was like, who did ever attend a time series presentation at PyData? This is the second one we have today. But I will start with, come in. I will start with talking about how it can help us to accelerate renewable energy transition. So renewable energy, for example, wind turbine, delivers the energy to the electricity grid. And the electricity grid always needs to be in balance. So if your laptop is empty, for example, my laptop is empty, I want to plug it in. The electricity that I take out at the grid at that exact moment of time has to go into the grid somewhere. For example, generated by a wind turbine. However, it's quite challenging actually to balance this grid all the time. And now it becomes even more challenging because wind energy is uncertain. With a gas plant, for example, you could choose the day ahead the amount of energy I want to produce tomorrow. So I can make an estimation of the demand and I can set it. But with wind, how much wind is there going to be tomorrow exactly at that second of the day? I don't know. I can only forecast it. And the percentage of wind and solar energy in the grid is increasing. So the grid gets more and more dependent on this uncertainty. So the solution for that is to forecast that uncertainty explicitly. It can very much help in decision making, because it will be very different if you know that you're quite certain or that if you're very uncertain. If you're very uncertain, you probably have to take more measures to prepare to balance the grid. And if you forecast this uncertainty, you can do it in different properties of the energy market. So we can do it when we forecast supply. So what I talked about, if you forecast the wind or if you forecast solar. You can also do the same thing for demand, because demand always is a bit uncertain. And you can do the same thing if you forecast the price, because the price combines the production and the demand into one. So also that uncertainty procrastinates through in our price. So that's what we do at Dexter. And now dive into a little bit more of the technical details for you. So common point forecast metrics don't really give us any information about this uncertainty. So here you see a time series forecast with on the horizontal axis the time. So T0 is now, so we use the data until now to forecast into the future. And on the vertical axis, it can be any property. So what I talked about before, demand, demand production or price. But you can also keep your own case in mind. Maybe you're working on a forecast that you're making right now. Keep that in mind, because what I'm going to talk about, it's not only applicable to the energy market, but you can use it for any model that you have. That's the nice thing actually about this method. So we have a point forecast, but how certain is it? We have no clue. The only thing is that we know it's not going to be perfect, so it's never actually going to be correct. So one method to add some information about it is to add a prediction interval. So instead of having one point, you add two more points to give a range of certainty. So here on the slide, I gave an example that it's 90% interval. So expect 90% of the values to be within this range. And that indicates a little bit of certainty, because if it's very narrow, I'm very certain. If it's very wide, I'm very uncertain, and I know that I have to make my decision so that I can deal with that uncertainty that might happen. And I want to know that 90% of the value is actually within that interval, because there can also be methods that don't have the correct coverage. So it's called coverage if you talk about the amount of points that are actually within the interval that you give. And a method that can do that for us, that will give us correct coverage, is conformal prediction. So that's why I want to talk about that today. And a nice thing about the method is that it's independent of your model. So you can use any point forecast model that you already have. So any case you're working on, you can just keep using the same model that you have right now exactly as it is, but you just add some extra information. And with that, it also has the statistical guarantee that it will have the correct coverage there. So how can we do that? Because it sounds nice, but how are we actually doing that? Usually, if you would have a train set and a test set, now we need an extra data set, so we need to make one more split for a calibration set. So now we have a train set, calibration set, and test set, and the calibration set is going to give us some more information about its certainty. And we will do that in three steps. So we start with training, then calibration, then prediction. And I will go through them one by one. So training. I already said you can use any point forecast model. So here, you just train your model how you always do using your training set. It can be regression, it can be tree-based, but also deep learning, any model you have. So that's quite easy step. Then we go to the calibration. So now you predict with your model for the calibration set, and you're gonna look at the residuals. So the difference between the actual values that you have in your calibration set and the prediction that you made. In conformal prediction, those residuals are called conformity scores. So here in the slide, I indicated as an arrow, so the difference between your actual value and your prediction for that specific moment in time. You create a sorted list of the absolute conformity scores, and then you can select the specific quantile that you're interested in. And I also made this slide a little bit more how it resembles in Python. So the same thing again, but now I gave it some names. So here I have three errors. The biggest one is number one, and the smallest one is number three. I create actually the list. It's just an array with the absolute value starting with the biggest one. And I can select the quantile that I'm interested in. So for example, if I talk about that, it's the 90% interval, or it's the 40% interval. It depends on the question you want to answer, what kind of interval you want to look at. And you select that value. So here you have your confidence level. You do that 1 minus your confidence level times the length of the list. And then we're in Python, so do minus 1 because we start counting at 0. And then we have the index that you want to select in that list. So it's actually a pretty easy equation. And that value you need to keep when you make your prediction. So then we go to the last step. We predict our point forecast model. So again, this is not different for anything else that you would already have done. And then we just add the prediction interval on top of it. So the width of the prediction interval, we found that in the calibration step. It's just a set width. You just add it around the forecast that you have. So you sum it or you subtract it. And you can see in the graph as well that it's constant over the test set that I'm predicting for. So if I'm forecasting, for example, for 1 day, it will be constant over that full day. So small recap. You train your point forecast model. You use the calibration set to look what actually happens in the actual values in the calibration set. And based on that, you can add a prediction interval about your forecast. Now talk about Python. We're here at PyData. There's nice packages that you can use for this that make it very easy to do this. So I think the most used package is MAPI. It's a really early package that was developed. It's very extensive. And a bit newer package that I personally like a lot is Krebs. I find it a little bit more user-friendly, especially if you want to dive into the code and read what actually happens. But that's a personal preference. You can use both of them. They do pretty much the same thing. So how would that look like if I do that in Python? So it's not that big of a difference. Only instead of my normal baseline model. So here the baseline model would be that point forecast model. So it could be a light GBM model. It can be a regression model. Just the model you're usually using. You wrap that one. You fit it how you usually do it. And here I called the train set PropTame because it doesn't contain the calibration set. So it's only the training part. You calibrate it, so then you have one extra step, and you can predict both your value and the interval around it. So you have, in the point prediction, it will be one array with one value per sample that you're predicting, and then in the interval it will be two, so the top one and the lower one. So here you can also see that if you have your prediction, you see you forecast a constant prediction interval around it, and your actual values will be somewhere. So this is actually quite a simple method that makes it nice to use, especially because you can almost always use it. So that's always a good start. It has a lot of advantages. I already mentioned it quite some time. It doesn't depend on the model. It's model agnostic, so you can just start with the model you're already using. It has a statistical guarantee, so you know the coverage is going to be correct, which is not the case for most other methods. And you don't need to make any assumptions on any distribution. So you know, don't need to say like it's a Gaussian. It really uses the distribution of the data set. There's also some disadvantages. I will dive into them a bit more on the next slides. It's constant over the prediction set, so you have quite little information in between the points. And it also, a prediction interval doesn't provide you the information that a full distribution would do, actually. So the first one, constant over the prediction set, you're probably not forecasting one point at that moment, but multiple points. Maybe in my case it would be every 15 minutes of a day. And I have, in general, in machine learning problems, you have a lot of data. So you have all this input data about these points of the day, and I know that this one point is going to be very different than the other points, because that's how I make my forecast. So I actually would like to use that as well, because maybe one point would be more certain than the other point as well. And I'm now not using all that information that I'm having. And then next, the prediction interval provides less information than a probabilistic distribution, so it only gives you 3 points. And actually, so here on the left, I just added the interval over time. If you would take like a slice of that and you would draw the distribution, the interval would be 3 points, but the actual distribution can still have any shape within and can also have very different shapes for the same interval. So I'm still missing some information that I might need to make the correct decision based on this. One disclaimer, you can also repeat this many times. Then you also get kind of a distribution, but there's better methods for that. I get to that in a moment. So that are the disadvantages. So in the next part of the presentation, I will actually talk about another solution that solves exactly these advantages. So the first part I talked about how you go from a point prediction to a prediction interval. So you go from a model that doesn't give you any information about uncertainty to something that does give you information about that. In the second part of this presentation, I'm going to talk about calibrating a probabilistic forecast. So you already have a probabilistic forecast. You already know something about the uncertainty, but we're going to make sure it's correct. And to do that with conformal prediction is very similar as the previous part I explained. We're going to do the same 3 steps again. In every step, I'm going to explain what's the difference. So let's start with training. So the same thing as in the previous part, you can use any model. The only difference is it has to be a probabilistic model. So it has to give you information about more than just a point forecast. It has to give you preferably the whole distribution. So then you're talking more about quantum regression, about the quantum regression forest, also some kind of LSTMs that do that for you. So that's then your starting point. So this is a bit more specific cases that you would talk about. And something to keep in mind is that this distribution here, just draw it as one line, you could kind of divide it into prediction intervals. So you could say that this is a lot of prediction intervals, one going from 1% to 99%, one going from 2% to 98%, and so on, 40 to 60%, you name it. And those intervals is what we're going to use to calibrate. First, the question, who's working with probabilistic time series forecasting? Okay, see some people. Who's working with quantum regression? Still some people, nice. But also for the people that don't work with it, I want to take a little moment to step a little bit out of the conformal prediction only and talk about quantum regression so that you also have a model in mind that would be the starting point to do this. If quantum regression, the reason that I picked that one is because it's the most used, then it's called conformalized quantum regression. So if you want to Google it, it's a good term to start with. So quantum regression, what do? You want to have not just a point forecast, but the full distribution. So what we do is we train one model for every quantile. So if you can decide how many quantiles you want to look at, but if I want to look at every percentage, for example, I'm going to train 99 models for percentage 1, 2, up till 98, 99. And all those models are going to give me a value. If I put them next to each other, I have the distribution. And a very nice thing about it is because you train your model, you're using all the input features, it's going to differ for different samples that you make your prediction for. So it's not, if I make a prediction, it will not be constant over time. It really adapts to the input space. But if we train 99 models, how are we going to make sure that not all of those models give me exactly the same prediction? Why are they different in that point prediction? So we do that in the loss function. So usually you have a symmetric loss function. So I want to give the best prediction possible. So in a training, I'm going to make predictions and I'm going to compare to the actual values of your train set. And I'm going to count something that's too high with the same weight as something that's too low. I end up in the best estimation that I can give. But this can also be asymmetric. So then the errors on one side, I will count more heavily than on the other side. So if it's too low, I will count it more heavily, for example, than when it's too high. So if the values that are too the errors that are too low, you count them more heavily, your model will become a bit careful there and start moving to the lower side. So here for 20%, you will clearly see that the left side will be steeper. If you would do this plot for 1%, it would be even more asymmetrical. And the same holds for the higher quantiles, then it's just the other way around. The higher part is steeper. And this loss function is called pinball loss. The reason that it's called pinball loss is because it looks like the jump that is made on a pinball machine. So you can keep that in mind if you want to remember the term. Think about the pinball machine, the ball that's going all around, you end up at the pinball loss. So this is going to give us the probability distribution. So the pinball loss for 20% will be used in one model, pinball loss for 80% in the other model, and those are going to forecast something differently. And then something very nice about it is that in Python, it's super easy. So we work quite a bit with LightGBM. So if you have a LightGBM model, you only add objective is quantile. You add the quantile that you want to do, and you don't have to worry about it anymore. It's just going to predict you that quantile. So if you want to have a whole distribution, you will have to do this multiple times. So I see you a little bit wondering, like, why you're talking about conformal prediction? This quantum regression is awesome. It adapts to my input space. It gives me the whole probability distribution. That's everything I need. I already know the certainty. Why would I need conformal prediction still? A big difference is that if you use conformal prediction or conformalized quantum regression, you have the statistical guarantee of valid coverage. So it really uses the distribution of your calibration set and it matches that on average your prediction is correct. So you know that on average the prediction will be exactly the distribution of your data set. While for machine learning models, they're asymptotically consistent. So they go towards the correct Kamantau. So in a world where you would have the perfect feature space and everything from reality is included in all of your data, you will have the perfect Kamantau. But yeah, who has that ever? Cleaning up data is still an interesting topic as well. So if you have a bit more of a simplification, sometimes you will be correct, but sometimes you can very much overestimate or underestimate the width of your distribution. While for conformal prediction, regardless of your input features, it can be a super simple model that you're using as a starting point. You know that on average it's going to be correct. Then the other way, quantum regression also has advantages compared to conformal prediction because it's a very effective way to use actually your input space. So it adapts to all the information that you have about that specific sample, where the basic application of conformal prediction doesn't do it, and also there is methods for it, but actually quantum regression is just a very practical and effective way. So it's not without reason that big part of the world is using conformalized quantum regression. Because conformalized quantum regression really combines the best of both. You use the ease and practical advantages of quantum regression, but you still have that statistical guarantee. So, now we're gonna calibrate. And now we're gonna do it per interval of the probabilistic prediction. So last time we did it only once, now we're gonna repeat it for every prediction interval that we already made with our model. So instead of comparing to one line, we're gonna compare it to an interval. So it's either out of the interval or in of the interval. And we wanna make sure that if we have the interval from 30 to 70%, 40% of the points is actually within that interval. So we list all of the residuals, so all of the differences between the actual value and the closest line of the interval as conformity scores. This time it's not the absolute values. And we select again the quantile that we are interested in. So if it's a positive value, it will give you a wider distribution. So you're actually more uncertain than what your model said. If it's a negative value, it will give you a more narrow distribution. So you're actually more certain than what your machine learning model said. So that is, and then that gives you the correction factor. And that correction factor is still constant for your whole set, but because your starting point already varies to the input space, your full prediction will vary. And then we're gonna forecast. So we again make the forecast just as we usually would, this time with the probabilistic forecast. And as a second step, we add the correction factor that will either make the distribution wider or more narrow. We do that for every quantile, and we end with a calibrated probabilistic forecast instead of just a probabilistic forecast. The full overview, again, the same steps. Train, calibrate on your calibration set, and just after prediction, apply your correction factor that you found. So now actually, all the disadvantages that I named before became advantages, because we still have those nice things. It still doesn't rely on the model you choose. You have the statistical guarantee. You have no distribution assumptions beforehand. And it varies over your test set or prediction set. And it gives you a full distribution. So it looks almost too good to be true. I have to say there was one disadvantage that I didn't mention yet so far. So we also have an assumption of exchangeability. So we don't do assumptions on the distribution of the data, but there is an assumption that's quite important, and that's the assumption that your data is exchangeable. So that you could move them around over time. And for time series, that's not always the case. So you can have a data drift. So here I gave an example where you clearly see that the beginning of the time series seems to have a different pattern than the end. So it doesn't really hold that you can just freely randomly select your calibration set and freely use that to give the distributions. There are also solutions for that. And those solutions actually focus more on the last part of the time series that you have in your data set. So they add more weight to that. But I have to say with that, if you apply it, you lose the statistical guarantee and it gets asymptotically consistent. So it's a trade-off. But if you're interested in that and you want to dive into it more, look at the MAPI time series regressor. You'll find a lot of information there and it's a good starting point. So, three learnings about conformal prediction that we had today. First, it has the statistical guarantee, something we're not used to with having in our machine learning models, and super nice to actually have that. Because you're certain that independent on your features, it's going to be on average correct. Then you can make it conditional very easily if you apply conformalized quantum regression. And lastly, it can help to accelerate the renewable energy transition. But I really believe it can also help to accelerate a lot of other topics as well. And I'm not the only one talking about this topic, because it's really a topic that's rising in interest. You can see here that at the start of 2022, people started Googling it clearly more. So what that makes this topic very interesting to keep following, because it's still in development. It gets more and more attention, and new updates are coming all the time. So if you would like to do that and you like to follow this topic, you can go to this repository. And gives you a lot of information. It's really extensive, so it gives you a lot of information and will also give you new updates on this topic. And you can also see that this repository in the Git stars, it started in the start of 2022. So I don't think it's a full coincidence that here it starts at the same moment. So it's a good place to get your information from. So that was my presentation. Thank you very much all for coming. And if you like the topic and you actually want to apply it in a notebook, we're going to also have a workshop in January. So it's going to be about the same topic, but we have more time and we're actually going to do it ourselves in Python. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Inge. We have time for a couple questions.
I have a question regarding the quantile regression. Did you encounter crossing quantiles? And if you did, how did you go about that?
Yeah, we have that. You can either interpolate it or you can just switch them around. That are the things we use quite simple, but for us it works fine. Yeah, it does happen that the quantile, that they don't actually are nicely in line. So what we actually eventually did was just switching them around, but then we tried to also take the average of the values that it always increases, so it takes the average of 3 points. Yeah, common problem.
Thank you very much. I would like to ask if this method can work also for a multi-input, multi-output time series model.
Yeah, interesting. I would say it would work, but I haven't used it. But I would assume that you can apply the same thing, because then you would just have multiple errors because you have multiple outputs.
Asymptotes a model, and then the model is trying to predict other time series.
So you don't have in your training data the time series that you want to predict? Or extra features?
The outputs of the model. You have different inputs and outputs.
Yeah, so you train the target is still the same time series as you want to predict, but you have extra input features.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, so then the conformalized quantum regression is super nice, because then you use actually those extra input features. In the first part of the presentation, you would still use those features to make the point forecast, but the prediction interval would be totally independent of them.
thanks for the cool talk, first of all. The thing that you mentioned at the end with the data exchangeability, can I think of that as the same thing as stationarity of the time series, or is it more strict and there's no seasonality possible? Or
No, I would say that it's non-stationary. Yeah. Okay.
My question is about the calibration set.
Yeah.
So how did you pick it? Because I imagine if you take random samples, then you start to, let's say, create gaps in the time series.
Yeah.
Or if you take the latest data, you also create a lag in the training of your model that is not trained on.
Yeah, the most general approach is to just take random samples. So you have gaps. You can also sometimes even reuse it in the train set and the calibration set. But on general, you just take your train set, you take parts out of it, and then you use that in your calibration set. And then in the last part where I talked about focusing more on the recent ones, you have to weigh those more.
Okay, thank you. I think this is all the time we have for questions. Thank you so much. And
I will stick around.
Yes, please. Thank you.